This line of code is the Shellshock exploit, and I'm using it here to check whether my system is vulnerable to the Shellshock bug, which some would say is even more damaging than Heartbleed. I'm using the echo command to print out some text, and I'm passing this into the Shellshock exploit so that if the system is vulnerable, it'll print out vulnerable to the screen. And as we can see on here, it's printed out vulnerable, so this system is vulnerable. So this system that I'm logged into is on our local network, whereas this one is my local laptop and has been patched. So if I execute the code on here, it doesn't print vulnerable because the machine isn't vulnerable. Shellshock is a bug in a program called Bash. Now, for those of us who use Unix-like systems such as BSD, OSX, Solaris, and of course Linux, sorry, GNU Linux, we'll be very familiar with this program. It is what's called a shell. Now, Unix-like systems are primarily command line based. It's similar to those, if you remember, DOS on PCs before that, and the command prompt that you get in Windows. So Bash itself is a GNU re-implementation of a shell that was developed by Stephen Bourne in the late 70s. He developed, and it's documented in this technical report from Bell Systems, the Bourne shell. It was named after himself, which was an improvement on the original Thomson shell. One of the big benefits of the shells in Unix, as well as enabling you to interpret commands that you type in, you can write what are called shell scripts. Now, a shell script is just a series of commands that are placed into a text file that you can then execute to do useful things. So this is a script I wrote to check my mail every time I logged in. All it is a series of standard Unix commands that are executed in order, and it does some processing of the output of these commands to tell me either that I have no new mail or how many messages I have. I wrote this script when I was an undergraduate here, and it's been running on the systems ever since. Now, this script is quite useful because it shows us some of the more advanced features of Bash. One of the examples of this is that we can set variables in Bash. One of the other things we can do is create functions. And just like a function in a programming language is a series of things that you can execute and call several times, Bash scripts allow us to define functions that we can call several times within our Bash script to do something useful. You can also pass variables down from one program into any program that it calls. These are referred to as environment variables. So in this example, we've got the term variable, which is set to say this is a 16-color X term. Any program can look at that and see what type of terminal it's on and then generate the correct codes to, say, set the color to be red if it's possible. You can also create functions that can then be passed into Bash on the environment. And it's this ability to create environment functions, as they're called, that is being exploited in the Shellshock exploit. So for instance, we could create a function called hello, and we put in the opening and closing bracket, a curly brace, and then we can put in the commands that we want to execute. In this case, echo hello Computerphile. And if we then pass that into a new instance of Bash, when we type hello, note the misspelling, that's deliberate, it executes those commands, and in this case prints out hello Computerphile. What people realized with the Shellshock bug is that after that definition of the function, if you put a semicolon after this function definition, which to Bash means there's more commands to come, and then put in some extra commands, say like echo hello Brady, then when we start this, Bash starts executing them. Because it's no longer as part of the function, it just starts executing them. It says hello Brady, even though I've never told Bash directly to do that. Now, why is this an exploit? It's a bug, but why is this exploitable? I could have just typed echo hello Brady at the keyboard and had exactly the same effect. The problem is that shell scripts are very much used as the glue on Unix systems to stick everything together. So the environment variables are passed around from process to child process all the time, and are normally normal things like what terminal are you running on, what's the current user, what's the current directory. If we've set one up that contains our malicious code, eventually something will run Bash, and as well as running the code that's checking for our emails, because Bash is buggy, it'll run this extra bit of code of ours as well. Where this becomes a real problem is when environment variables are used to pass things into systems that perhaps we don't even have access to. So a common example of this would be a web server. The other thing we want to be careful is that Bash is used on lots of systems, for example NAS boxes, smartphones and so on, so they all should be patched as well to make sure that there's no lurking exploits on systems that you perhaps didn't think about.
So my phone could have Bash on it.
Yeah.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for sponsoring this Computerphile video. If you go to audible.com/computerphile, you'll find loads of books to choose from, and there's a chance to try one out for free. Today I'd like to recommend How We Got to Now by Stephen Johnson. It looks at some of the things we've come to rely on in modern life, like spectacles and fridges and Wi-Fi. For instance, Hedy Lamarr, the movie star, had a hand in the underlying technology that drives Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Who knew? So check out How We Got to Now. Go over to audible.com/computerphile. Try a book out for free. Thanks once again to them for sponsoring this video.
So it's a bit like panning for gold. We stick our metaphorical sieve into the mud and we pull out things and we're shaking it about. And occasionally all we pull out is mud, just random data that we can't decipher. But occasionally we pull out and we start together and we get those gold nuggets that we're interested in.